on Lord Balaram, but he didn't tell me where. So maybe someone can ask him which verses he wants me to speak on. I choose, huh? Well, I'm not too can find too many verses in the seventh canto, so. Do we have a tenth canto here? Chapter 21. I'm not sure. Starting tomorrow. Okay, we'll do. So we'll continue with today's series. Huh? Everyone's going to retreat? Well, maybe there'll be. Punch it. Prabhupada may come, depends. Really? Okay. All right. As long as you don't ask me to ask you any questions. I might. So, Hare Krishna. All right, so tomorrow we'll begin the Balaram, Jayanti. It's getting ready for his appearance on Monday, on the 3rd. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjavi Ahira Jaya Radha Madhava Kunjavi Ahira Jai Gopi Janavallabha Gary Vara Jai Gopi Janavallabha Gary Vara Yasodhanandana Braja Janahanjaya Yasodhanandana Braja Janahanjaya Jamuna Thira Havana Yahaniyam Jamuna Thira Havana Yahaniyam Jai Radha Madhava Kunjavihaniyam Jai Radha Madhava Kunjavihaniyam Jai Gopi Janavallabha Giri Bharatahiyam Gopi Janavallabha Jai Gopi Janavallabha Tomorrow will begin. But I have a question for everyone. Let's see if you can. It's either yes or no. It's an easy question. Does Balaram play a flute? Anybody? You said no?
Yes.
Who says no? Any knows? You're not sure?
Okay.
Everybody agrees? Yeah,
no.
He plays flute.
He plays. I said he plays.
You saw him, right? He was down the street playing the flute. You
heard
him. That was an argument. When I was in Vrindavan, the head of the Krishna Balaram temple in Nandagram, he was talking to us and telling us that somebody was criticizing that they put a flute in Balaram. And because if you go to Nandagram, Krishna and Balaram were standing there with flutes on the altar. So somebody, I guess it was a Brijabasi or somebody, said, would you get this idea? Balaram plays the flute. And then he said, here. The cowherd girl said, "Oh friends, those eyes that see the beautiful faces of the son of Nanda Maharaj are certainly fortunate. As these two sons enter the forest, surrounded by their friends driving the cows before them, they hold their flutes to their mouth and glance lovingly upon the residents of Vrindavan. For those who have eyes, we think there is no greater object of vision." Okay.
So,
yeah, they play flutes, they play horns, they beat drums. Yeah. Well, one time one devotee was playing flute, and Prabhupada said, no flute. I guess he thought he was Krishna, so... So yeah, we can play flutes if we are instructed by the spiritual master to do so. Okay, so we'll go on with this very powerful section of the Bhagavatam. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Tat Prayaso Na Kartavyo. Yata Ayur Vaya Param. Natata Vindate Shemam. Mukunda Charanam Bujam. Taprayaso na kartavyo. Yata ayur vayaparam. Natata vindate shemam. Mukunda charanam bujam. Taprayaso na kartavyo. Yata ayur vayaparam. Natata vindate shaimam. Mukunda karanam bujam. I guess there is some ladies out there. Oh, yeah, there's one or two. Okay. Anyone else? Okay. Tat, for that, sense gratification and economic development, prayasa, endeavor, na, not, kartavya, to be done, yata, from which, ayu vaya, waste of the duration of life, param, only or ultimately. Na, nor, tata, in this way, vindate, enjoys, shemam, the ultimate goal of life, mukunda, the supreme personality of Godhead, who can deliver one from the material clutches, Charana Ambujam, the lotus feet. Mm. Okay, translation. Endeavors merely for sense gratification or material happiness through economic development are not to be performed, for they result only in the loss of time and energy with no actual profit. If one's endeavors are directed towards Krishna consciousness, one can surely attain the spiritual platform of self-realization. There is no such benefit from engaging oneself in economic development. Would any economists out here? No? No economists? Okay. We see the materialistic persons busily engaged in economic development all day and all night, trying to increase their material opulence. But even if we suppose that they get some benefit from such endeavors, that does not solve the real problem of their lives. Nor do they know what the real problem of life is. This is due to a lack of spiritual education. Especially in the present age, every man is in darkness, in the bodily conception of life, not knowing anything of the spirit soul and its needs. Misguided by the divine leaders of society, people consider the body to be everything, and they are engaged in trying to keep the body materially comfortable. Such a civilization is condemned because it does not lead humanity towards knowing the real goal of life. People are simply wasting time and the valuable gift of the human form because a human being who does not cultivate spiritual life dies like the cats and dogs, is degraded in his next life. From human life, such a person is put into the cycle of continuous birth and death. Thus, one loses the true benefit of human life, which is to become Krishna conscious and solve life's problems. Om Vijnanta Midandasya Ginajana Salakaya Chaksu Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manovistam Staptitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadam Mayam Dadati Swam Padantikam Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimakti Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Bhauravani Pracharine Nir Vishesha Shunyavadi Pastyatya Desatarine Vanchakalpa Tarubhischa Kripa Sindhu Vebacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namaho Namaha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram, Hare Ram, 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 Hare Hare. There's a verse in the, can't think of the first word of the verse, but it's in the first canto, fifth chapter, verse number 18. Natasyam karnam karnam avidyate, natasyam srotam, but no, that's not it. Anyway, the verse explains in two principles that actually, one who is actually philosophically inclined does not endeavor for any upito na labhyate te pravatam upariyada na labhyate tad uparan na labhyate tad upariyada. What's the last line? Kalena sarvatran gambira ramhasa. So in the first part of the verse, those who are actually intelligent do not endeavor in a philosophical way for any position anywhere within the three realms of existence. Because, and then the second part of the verse gives a little bit of an understanding of the first part, which says that as far as sense gratification is concerned, that will automatically come, or as far as material happiness is concerned, that will automatically come, just like no one tries for material miseries, but they come automatically. So this verse really is, it's actually spoken by Lord Brahma. It's a very powerful verse, or it's spoken by Narada Muni, either one, I'm not sure. It's a powerful verse, and what this it's saying is that you don't have to make any arrangements for your material life. Your karma is already there. It will come. You have good karma will bring you auspicious material results, and your other karma will bring you some suffering, some negativity. You can't change that, of course, unless you engage in devotional service. But the verse is instructed to people who are thinking that by working to make a better arrangement in the material world, I'll get more happiness. I mean, you can change your material situation, and people do that. And you can also change how you suffer and how you enjoy. But you can't change the amount. That's the point. The point is you're allotted so much material happiness and you're allotted so much material distress. So you're living in Slovenia, and then sometimes it's really cold in the wintertime, so you think, oh, I need to avoid the cold, so I'll go to a not warmer country. So I avoid the suffering that comes by the cold weather, but then I ride my bicycle and fall off and break my leg. So in other words, you're going to get the suffering one way or the other. You can't change it. Or you get bitten by a mosquito or something, who has malaria. So the point is that don't waste time, this is the point that's being made here, trying to make material arrangements to increase happiness and decrease stress. One should take up seriously the process of Krishna consciousness. And by that process, it's mentioned that whatever results of material happiness and distress and the happiness that will automatically come. Will automatically be destroyed by the process of Krishna consciousness. Some people don't like that. They say, oh, if you take the Krishna consciousness, well, I get rid of my material suffering, but you also get rid of your material happiness. That part they don't like. It's the half a hen philosophy. So the point is that material happiness is another form of suffering because it diverts one's attention to away from real happiness, which is Brahma-sokhyam, or Brahma-vidya, or Brahma-sokhyam. That happiness which is not dependent on any situation externally, but comes with our connection on the spiritual level. And that happiness is not external. It may manifest itself in activities that we perform, but the happiness comes in the form of the happiness within. The happiness of within, because happiness within is real happiness. If you're happy within, you can be happy without or outside. But if you're not happy inside, you can do so many things. When people do that, they have a lot of money, they have a lot of position, they have a lot of facilities to enjoy, but they can't because inside they're miserable. They're in anxiety. For whatever reason, they haven't understood that how real happiness comes from the heart. There's a little story that we tell sometime. It's just a little, what we say, antidote. One man, he's living in his home, so he hears that somewhere in the world there's a great treasure. So he decides, well, I'm going to find that treasure. So he gets out the maps, finds as many, hints as he can, information, where's that treasure. He's going this way and that way. He spends his whole life looking for the treasure, but somehow he dies before finding the treasure. So after that, the relatives found out about it. They claim his body. They bring him back to his home. They dig a hole in the ground in the backyard to place his body in, and guess what? There's the treasure. It's in his backyard. So that's the story of life. Everyone's looking for that happiness somewhere else, but it's right inside. When Hanuman was told that Sita and Ram are in his heart, he wanted to rip open his chest to see. He knew that, hey, if the Sita and Ram are in my heart, that's my happiness, then therefore I want to experience that. So yeah, here Prabhupada said, and Prabhupada's making this point, human life is so precious. Time is so valuable. That to waste time in materialistic endeavor, especially to gain money, just like there's many examples in the lives of devotees, and I think many devotees can also testify here, that as soon as you give up you know, your material life and start taking to Krishna consciousness. If you need money for something, somehow it comes. The devotees in the early days of Krishna consciousness in Berkeley, I think it was Shamsundar, Malati, and Guru Das, and Jamuna, those devotees there, they had a preaching center. Prabhupada had given them some instructions to preach through this one preaching center, but they had to pay the rent. And so there was time came for the rent money, and they didn't have the money. And in those days, because there was such a demand for an apartments, they were living in the, you know, the hippie area, and there was so many hippies coming in looking for places. So they would lose their apartment if they didn't, you know, pay the rent. So Malati tells the story. They were walking down the street discussing what to do, and all of a sudden Malati looks, and blowing in the wind, there's $100 bills. There's nobody around. There's just a wind blowing, and there's $100 bills flying in the air. So then immediately, of course, what they did was collect them, and it was enough for the rent money. Do you believe in God? Devotees tell another story in the Philadelphia temple where the rent was also due, was $250. It was in those days, it was $250, was a lot more value than it is now. And it was time for the rent. So the temple president was thinking what to do. Well, let's all go out on Sankirtan. So he took the whole temple, everybody. He left the pujari there for the deities and went out on Sankirtan. So all the devotees went out on Sankirtan. So while they were out on Sankirtan, some well-dressed gentleman comes up to one of the ladies and he hands her an envelope, says, thank you very much for what you're doing, and he walks away. They open the envelope, $250. So there's so many stories like that on how Krishna provides if we just have that faith and engage in Krishna consciousness. So there's a little prayasa that is required, a little endeavor to do things in order to maintain. But when it becomes the focus, then it's just a waste of time, because it takes our attention away from the real, what is not real, but the most valuable activity, which is devotional service. So we may make a little effort, especially those who have, you know, material responsibilities, to make some money. But the thing is, not a big endeavor, and not spending so much time. But generally, we depend on Krishna. And Krishna always takes care of his devotees. And if he doesn't, he has a reason why he doesn't provide whatever he doesn't provide, because there is something higher that is meant to be given to the devotee. So for whatever reason, we have full faith that whatever Krishna provides or doesn't provide, it's the best situation like that. So this economic development is really the focus of the whole materialistic society. Now they're all complaining about this COVID virus. It's causing some economic crunches all around the world. And they're all afraid that, you know, economies are going to start, and if it continues like this, and then there's going to be, you know. So they can't make $1 million, they can only make 100,000 then. That's what happens when economic development, and things start to crash. And then their feeling is, well, we can't make the biggest profit we have, but we can make but they're not happy with the smaller profit because they consider that, you know, satisfactory. So it's a greed. It's greed for money, greed for material things. It just destroys the whole society is destroyed because of that. Therefore, simple living and high thinking. And Prabhupada used those terms together to make a point that if you're living simply, then you can think about the goal of life. But if you're living too gorgeously or making arrangements for these gorgeous living beyond your needs, then you can't really, you know, focus on Krishna consciousness. And therefore, the Sri Yashupanishad says, Ishavasham idam sarvam yat kincha dyam jagat tena jaktena bunjitaha magridaha gusaswiddhanam. That everything animate and inanimate is owned and controlled by the Lord. And one should take their quota. In other words, everyone has a quota in order to live. So you might have to take a little while to understand what is my quota. But just to keep body and soul together, because the real goal in life is to become Krishna conscious. And that requires time. A lot of times we find devotees don't spend enough time becoming Krishna conscious. They want to become Krishna conscious, but they have too many other things going on in their life. But quantity also helps to build quality. The more we spend chanting, reading, associating, and performing the activities of devotional service, we build that consciousness. So it's important to use as much time, or what we say, all the time, in Krishna consciousness. Then it becomes easier. It's really a thing about quality. Just like there was a story with Srila Prabhupada when he was in India. He had been given a Pandal program in one place, I believe it was in Delhi, and government leaders were there for the program. So at the end of the program, one of the government ministers, he came up to Srila Prabhupada in full dandavats at Prabhupada's feet. And the devotees were quite new from America. They were quite shocked to see such an important person at a big position. He's falling flat in front of Prabhupada. Jai Sri Pancha Tattva Ki Jai. And so later, not right later, right after they asked Prabhupada, what is it about you that, you know, causes these people to, you know, act like that? You know, they were quite amazed to see that. And Prabhupada immediately said, I don't have any lust. I have no lust. And that was all he said. And then while they were going in the car, some of the devotees who had been there were riding with Prabhupada. Prabhupada got to his place, and then he got out, turned around, looked at the devotees. He said, it's not because I have no lust, it's because I have no time. So what he was saying, don't give Maya any time. If you want to keep Maya away, just don't give her any time. That's all. Who's that? Maya, oh really? I was expecting you tomorrow, not today. Come back tomorrow. Okay. Next day. Who's that? Maya, I said tomorrow. So tomorrow never comes, it's always today. So that's the idea. You have to keep postponing Maya. If you do that, you'll find it becomes easy to practice Krishna consciousness. Becomes easy because then we use our time in the way that is the most beneficial. So here Prabhupada really, in a very compassionate way, he speaks these words in the purport, how people are just wasting their life, wasting time, living like animals. They got such great benefit of having a human form of life. This is the heart of a pure devotee. He feels for the suffering of others. Although he's using strong words, he's not arrogant or condemning. He's just making a point. Don't waste your time. This is so valuable to get a human form of life. And Prabhupada would always say in many of his lectures that you don't know. He's talking to the non-devotees. You don't know what you'll be getting in your next life. You may not get human life again, and it's a good chance you won't. And so he's concerned that the living entities who are very dear to Krishna don't waste time. And for us as devotees, we have that understanding, but Maya is very tricky. She knows how to divert your attention away from Krishna. And see, Maya is like a, if you're in a ring and you're fighting, and the opponent hits the other person, and there's blood. So he's thinking, okay, that spot is vulnerable. Now he's going to try to punch that same spot again because he knows it's more vulnerable. So Maya knows that. She looks. She says, where's that person's weak spot? Why does she do that? Because she wants to make you strong. That way you cover the weak spot and make it strong. But if she hits your weak spot and you're not aware of that, and you succumb to that, then Maya's got you. So she knows your ins and outs. She knows your weak spots. Whatever your weak spot is, she knows. And she wants to hit you there or bring you there in order to help you become aware that this is your weak spot, and therefore you become Krishna conscious and deal with that. So we all know our weak spots, whatever they are. Sometimes we have to have other people telling us. But that is there. So be very, for devotees, therefore, Maya is always using different techniques to attract our attention to way, whatever it is. And as soon as you become strong in that area, she looks for another area to attack. Because she wants you to become a pure devotee. She wants you to become a pure devotee. And to become a pure devotee, you have to be able to be aware of where you're vulnerable to Maya and then become act in such a way as that you overcome that anartha, that weak spot, that a tendency for material attachments, material association like that. Okay, so these are a few points about wasting time through sense gratification, through economic development is the main thing here that Prabhupada, that Prahlad Maharaj is emphasizing. Any comments or questions? No questions.
Hare Krishna, thank you for the class. here in this verse, it kind of emphasizes how we shouldn't waste time with economic development, but sometimes we see, even though we're engaged in devotional service, our mind is not here, so we're kind of almost wasting our time in performing some what it might seem as devotional service on the outside. So how can we kind of try and avoid that, in Krishna consciousness, we don't waste time? And we're going to continue to progress.
How to prevent ourselves from wasting time? Knowing what you're going to be doing throughout the day and planning your day accordingly. And if there's a gap in the day, then you can just pick up your beads and start chanting or do something to fill in. But if we don't have a regulated schedule, then Maya will give you a schedule. She'll make you one of her, schedulees. So schedule is important to follow like that. You have an understanding, well, I get up at this time, I chant my rounds at this time, I go to the temple at this time, take breakfast at this time, and then I have activities after that, so what am I going to be doing? And then you always allow for things to come up. If devotees come or something comes up, then you don't become too rigid where you can... there are people who have such a rigid schedule that you can't talk to them. It's not my talking time, come back. So yeah, it's... you have to strive for regulation but not be attached to it. That's the point. Because that's another flaw, to be attached to regulation, but strive for regulation. Prabhupada was very regulated, extremely regulated. Even when he would travel, wherever he would wind up, he would pick up on that time period and begin wherever he was. So Prabhupada was amazing. He didn't have jet lag like we did. He was just so transcendental. Of course, he would rest sometimes, but still, he was always... aware of time and how to use time. He uses time very, very expertly. So that, you know, there's books on time management. There's one in the secular world. There's four things that they say. What is essential, what is important, what is non-essential, and what is not important. So you put all your activities in these four categories. What is essential, what is important, what is not essential, and what is not important. Not important means those things you can get rid of. Essential is we chant our rounds, right? That's essential. Important is some we read the books. That could be either essential or important, like that. So sit down, make a list of those things, put them in these four categories, and just see where you can increase the quality of your activities. But, you know, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita that, you know, by regulating the senses, then one can overcome this enemy of lust. Because the mind always likes to tell us what to do. It's always telling us what to do, or it's complaining about something. And Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati used to say, your mind's a non-devotee. We don't want to associate with non-devotees. Associate with Krishna, or with Krishna consciousness, ideas, feelings, thoughts, activities. So that's where regulation helps. It keeps that mind moving in the right direction. Does that help? Yeah, thank you. Yes, Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, thank you for the lecture. Yesterday I saw a lecture by His Holiness Bhakti Vikas Maharaj, and he was speaking about Indians. Indian devotees also, and Indians in general, they are somehow more pious, but on the other hand, even more materialistic than people in the West. They are so much attached, he says, to social position and wealth and luxury, which is not the case in the West. People are not so attached to luxury. I mean, these things. And he was being sarcastical about this, bringing up people in India they are saying to them, you know, get a good education so that that you can.
Janma Aishwara Sruta Shri Bir, yeah.
Yeah, and my question is, where does this come from? Even if in devotee families, they are doing all this effort to get these IT diplomas, getting big amounts of money, but if this amount of money would come without these IT diplomas, and they are devotees, they know about those things, those laws of karma.
Obviously, because of their pious activities, they have great facilities for material, you know, enjoyment. Yeah, that's mentioned, you know. These things come through pious activities. You have these opportunities to move in that direction, yeah. But they don't really see the value of spiritual attainment. That's it. Or they have a tendency to think, well, you know, I have to go through this, you know, stage of life, and then when I get old, and then because they have some piety, they may also have some connection to Vaishnava culture through their families and through society. They think later on in life. But it's not wrong to get a position in society. It's wrong to give up Krishna consciousness to that or substitute that for Krishna consciousness. So we have many people in the world who are of Indian culture, Indian nationality, who have big positions, and they do wonderful service for devotees, really wonderful service, you know. There was, Radhanath Swami got to associate with Barack Obama, and that was due to one Indian who has a big, big position in government. He arranged that. So, you know, so we can use these people who have big positions to help that, to help serve the mission of Krishna consciousness, like that. But if they give up their devotional activities, then that's a great loss for them. It's a great loss, you know. But then there's another tendency, is that because people who have been somewhat impoverished most of their traditions, generations, now see the world opening up to economic development, even India is doing that. So they think, oh, well, this is what we've been missing for many generations. Too much emphasis on spirituality. So that's another mentality. So we tell them, yeah, get a good job, go to school, get an education, if that's what you want, but become Krishna conscious. Because material life is, if you take up material life and you give up spiritual life, you lose both. But if you take up spiritual life, you may only lose material life. You lose material life anyway, because you can't keep whatever you gain. Time takes everything away. So, but the fascination towards the Western ideals of material development have created this mindset. And they have the facility, they have the intelligence. If you go to America, you see all the people who are IT operators in Google, and in what else, there's other places, what's that other? Microsoft, yeah, all these. They're either, there's a few Chinese in there and the rest are all Indians. When, you know, Trump wanted to stop bringing people from other countries, he was thinking to save American jobs. You know, there would be, the Westerners can't do these things that the Indians, and they don't have the brain for it. Because their brains are so screwed up from sense gratification. So the best IT people are just like, you know, all Indians. Because their brains are not so screwed up by sense gratification. The more you have sense gratification, the more you can't think straight. Or you can think how to enjoy, that's all you can do. Yeah. So Indians are, you see, you go to schools, and maybe you don't see it here so much, but I know in London and America, the highest kids in the classes are Indians. Practically all the schools. They're the best achievers. Yeah. Because their brains are, they got pious credits like that. So we don't fault that, we just fault if they make that their focus. All right, get an education, get a good, nice position, and become Krishna conscious, though. Don't give up your culture. As Prabhupada was chastising the Indian community in Toronto when he was there in 1976, I believe, he was using the word brashta. Don't become brashta. Brashta means fallen. It was the largest Indian community in North America at the time. And he was just chastising. Yeah, right. Okay, go on with your life, but don't give up your culture. Your culture is your happiness, your source, your wealth. You can't tell them not to go for those things. They just won't listen. It's going to be useless. Because they got the tendency and they got the karma. They're going to do it. So just direct them towards Krishna. Just like there's one devotee I just found out recently. He's in Chicago. And I used to know him. He's a Bengali. He would sit in class. And he would ask me questions. And I would give him answers. He couldn't get the answers right. He always asked me another question. So just now, I mean, he started his own company in Chicago just recently. And now the boy's in his 20s, and he's a millionaire already. And now he was made a devotee by the temple president of Chicago, because he was going to college, and so that didn't, our temple president was preaching in that college, made him a devotee. Now he's got his own company, and he's a millionaire. So what is he going to do with that money? He's going to help Krishna consciousness. He's helping the temple, he's helping, and he's also practicing Krishna consciousness. So there's nothing wrong with that, as long as they stay in the spiritual, you know, stream, you might say. Otherwise, you can't tell them not to do it. It's just, you know, just the way it is. Anything else? Other questions? Thank you. Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Hare Krishna Mahamantra Ki Jai.